Good afternoon, good evening, or good morning, wherever you are. Welcome to our webinar today. Well, the second one today that we've had with Richard. So today we're talking all about fine art printing and various different printing techniques directly from Capture One. As I'm no expert in that respect, then we have a guest today to help me. So I'm the guy at the top. My name's David. I'm part of the software sales team based out of Copenhagen in Denmark. And then we also have Richard Boutwell, who's a photographer and printmaker based out of Pennsylvania in the USA. So you're there, I hope, Richard.
Yes, I'm right here.
Yep, yeah, he's lurking in the background. Yep. So we're going to hear lots more from Richard in a moment. We have a 60-minute session that we're going to do today. You're very welcome and encouraged to ask questions throughout. The way you do that, if you look at the bottom of your GoToWebinar control panel, you'll see a section called Questions. Put a question in there, and that will come straight through to me. And I'll basically moderate them for Richard and pass on the questions to Richard that are of a common theme or obviously most relevant to today's subject as well. I am recording the session as well, so don't feel you have to remember everything or remember every single step of the way. You can always review again. So my advice is just to sit back and relax and take in the information, which is going to inspire you to look further. And then again, as I said, you can review as and when necessary on our YouTube channel. Look out for some follow-up links in 24 hours or so, which will have links to where the recordings are and so on. And Richard will also send out an email as well from his database with more resources too. So that's quite enough of me talking. So what I'm going to do is just hopefully through the magic of the internet, pass you over to Richard. So in a second, we hopefully should be seeing Richard's screen. So, yep, we can, Richard. That's coming in perfectly. So as
Okay.
I said, I'll hand you off to Richard, and then as the questions come in, I will fire them over to Richard at suitable time. So cheers, Richard. Over to you. Perhaps you might want to just briefly state or start by saying who you are and what you do, so everyone has a bit of background.
Yeah, sure thing. Thank you. So I just kind of started doing photography about year 2000. Came as a from through as a musician and just kind of dove right into photography and almost immediately just started working for people in a darkroom and done that for the last, 15 years maybe now. But in around 2007, I transitioned to doing digital work rather than like printing in the darkroom. Now I'm just doing drum scans and printing for photographers. So in addition to that, I'm teaching workshops, doing one-on-one instructions, and writing a whole lot about this digital black and white, kind of taking a lot from the analog world and kind of translating that to people working digitally now. So that's just a quick background. I know I'm going to talk a little bit quick. I'll try to slow it down, but this is essentially a two-day workshop crammed into 1 hour. So this is just a bit of an overview, and feel free to ask questions. We might have a little time at the end to kind of chat about those, or interrupt me as I go along here. So what I'm going to do first is just kind of get set up for printing. Right now we have one image on the screen. If you go up to view, you might have something that says show or hide overlay or show browser. Nope. Ooh, I forgot where it went now. I just turned it off. Anyway, you might have a thing at the bottom here with your
Oh, you're talking about labels, Richard. So show
Yeah, exactly.
labels. Yep, that's fourth one down, second category. I can never find it as well.
Yeah, exactly. I'm looking at it right now. I still can't even see it. But anyway, you oh well, we'll worry about that later. But in the last one I had those on there. It's kind of distracting when you're going to the printing mode, so you just want to turn those labels off. The next thing we want to do is have a little bit more margin around it. So I always like to preview with a white screen because it simulates like a paper white if you're showing prints unmatted or like the color of a mat if it's in a frame. So if we had this default gray background on here, I'm just going to go up to preferences and go to appearance. You might have the medium or dark, and that you can immediately see how that changes how these tones are represented in the preview here. So what I like to do is change this to white. And then you have these margins. So you can see if I move that one up, it comes quite a lot. This is just the standard margin. I leave that around 3 to 5 pixels. And the proof margin, it might, you know, it might come in at like 20. I like to just put it between 30 and 50 pixels. Depending on how large your screen is, how much screen real estate you have, it'll help just give a little bit of a little more reference, white reference around the top and bottom of the image. So when I set okay there and I go to the second, I'm sorry, the third of the three buttons above the viewer, you'll, if I turn that off, you have the standard margin and then you have the proof margin there. So that just gives a little bit more white space around the image and a little better kind of frame of reference for like the sky is pretty bright here. Now we can see just how far off paper white that is. In general, I don't like a lot of paper white in my images. You know, your eye gets immediately drawn to the lightest thing in the picture. So, and also you can start to see paper white depending on how the dots from the printer are spread. So I like to keep like maybe a 5%, 5 to 2% gray as my lightest thing in the image. And we'll look at color readouts later to kind of see how you can tell exactly how much ink is being laid down based on the RGB values of your color readouts. We'll get that in a minute. So when I'm doing most of the work, I leave it as the color space. So I'm looking in the process recipe and the output cog. It's this, it'll be towards the end. I have a custom setup here. So, you know, feel free to rearrange these however you like. I just use these like in the order of ease of use and how frequently I use them. So in the process recipes, you'll see a bunch of different ones here. There's some ones that come in by default and you can add them by hitting the little plus button. But I use the 16-bit full-size TIFF with the color space of Adobe RGB. And that is because the Adobe RGB has the same gamma as the gray gamma 2.2. So if I just convert to grayscale from here, the values are not gonna change as they're being sent to the printer. You know, if this were a Profoto RGB, that has a gamma of 1.8, and there would be some adjustment, so our readouts might not be exactly the same if we just, you know, change color or export to Photoshop and then convert. So I just leave this for the most part when I'm doing most of the work right with Adobe RGB. So now we're gonna just kind of jump right into printing. So the first little workthrough I'm gonna show you is using the color Epson driver with the manufacturer's paper profile. So we're gonna add a little bit of color to this. If you print just a perfectly gray neutral image, which is a lot of people's goal, I tend to recommend adding a little color depth to it. If you have two prints that have exactly the same tonal values, but one has a little bit of a little bit of color in it, like maybe a little warmth or even a little coolness, it'll have a feeling of richness rather than just like the straight neutral print. I tend to print a little on the warm to selenium side. That kind of mimics what you would do in the darkroom with like a standard enlarging paper with a selenium tone bath. Just, you know, makes a little bit of warmth. And if you go too far, you can go almost a little purple, like a little reddish purple. So I don't tend to go too far. Usually I want these to match what I would do in the darkroom. Like if I were having a show, I would have some 8x10-inch contact prints and some digital enlargements, and I want them to have roughly the same print hue. So I would do something like this. We're looking in the black and white tool tab. We're gonna go to split tone. It's the second of those two tabs. And you can say, you can change the hue of the print. And first we need to actually increase the saturation. And as soon as we do that, you'll see it turns red. If you want a straight toning, same as the midtones, highlights and shadows, you just make these two sliders. You can like 24, and then the saturation, make it 5 to 10. You'll see if this gets increased very, you know, very little, it has a pretty dramatic effect. So unless you're doing something kind of crazy where you want to mimic like a cyanotype or, you know, it's, you can get some wild split tones. And for some kinds of things that might work really well, for, you know, the traditional looking prints, that might be too extreme and not what you would want people to see. Or if you're having a show with other people, it might, you know, it's kind of up to you and your work, but this is just like a general guideline, that's a good place to start. So this, you know, I'm gonna go a little bit, this is starting to go toward the green side for me. So I'm just gonna back off to someplace in the mid 30s, mid to upper 30s, it seems to be okay. And we can even add a little bit more in the shadows and in the highlights. We keep those highlights a little more neutral, so we can even back off the saturation a little bit. But you see, it's just very little. So to use this toning that we're doing with the color values, we're going to need to print with a color driver and using an ICC profile. So I'm just going to jump right back to the output tab. And here we can click on another process recipe. I'm going to go down to this where it says PA100 Canson Platine. This is not the, it's turning red because of the page size or the print size is larger than the paper size. That's why you're seeing this red output at the bottom. So I'll just change that. Maybe 7x7. Not sure why that's doing that.
Oh, it's because it's not checked.
Oh, I don't have it highlighted. There we go.
There we go.
Okay. So here I'll go to a profile. We're not actually going to use that Canson Platine. I've just put a profile in for Ilford Gold Mono Silk. So that's put in there, and that is going to that's going to preview those colors based on the ICC profile. And so it looks like it's not as toned as we like, then we can go back to the toning and maybe increase the saturation just a little bit. So before we're going to print, we're going to just take a quick minute to talk about sharpening, and final printing adjustments. So in the local adjustment tab, I have this hidden layer at the top of the stack here, and I call that final printing adjustments. And I generally do that with a luminance curve, which is one of the nicest things about version 9, the addition of curves into the local adjustments. And you can see I basically use this for everything, very subtle adjustments and just burning and dodging with luminous curves. And I did a fairly large blog post about that for the Image Professor blog, Image Quality Professor blog, back in, I want to say, December even, maybe even November. But you can read that and watch my previous webinar that I go into how I do this kind of burning and dodging with local adjustments. But for the final printing adjustments, it looks, kind of looks okay here, but if we go to our color readouts, I'm going to switch over to this, go right to the bottom and say add color readout. It's going to pop up a bunch of readouts here. We can drag these around to different parts of the image and see what those RGB values are. So this 28, that's, I'm going to pop up another image real quick just as a reference here. So if we look on this grayscale, this is each luminance step from paper white all the way to the D-max of the paper. And 23 is about 90% black. What I kind of encourage people to do is print this out on your favorite paper, have it near where your workstation or in a viewing booth or where you generally judge prints. And before you print, just use a color readout and say, all right, I know that with this paper and this ink combination and this profile, this RGB value of 23 is going to print X, or this darkness. So you actually connect the numbers you're seeing here to an actual physical print, and it might give you some insight of how you can do some additional adjustments based on what the material actually is producing. So we're going to switch back over to our image, so we can see that 23 is ending up at about 90%. I'm going to say we need 28. That needs to be, that's a really deep shadow, that we want that to be a little bit darker. So what I'll do is just enable this, make that visible, that final printing adjustment curve there. And you see, I just moved the black point up a little bit and maybe increase the highlights a little bit. So that 23 is now like down to 12. We look back at our image, 12 is, just above a, what is that? 90, between 95 and 98%. Sorry, my screen's jumping a little bit here. So that's just a quick way to have a visual reference to what you're seeing and a way to do some final printing adjustments with a curve. Kind of really intuitive way to work with a curve. You just add a point, you can drag it up or down, watch the color readouts, and you can just have a very accurate preview of what you're gonna actually get in the print screen or in the actual physical print. So I'm gonna turn these off just by clicking white point or selecting the loop again. Now for sharpening, What I like to do is do a sharpening adjustment as a final printing adjustment, as a local adjustment. Here, I increased that pretty high. I was printing this on a matte paper when I was doing it. So glossy papers and, well, you know, sharpening is a whole other subject and we can get in fights about it all day long. But what I tend to do is use a local adjustment with a range between between 100 and 250 for like a glossy paper and maybe a little higher for a matte paper. It's going to really depend on your personal preferences and the tones in the image. If you have a really high contrast image, you might not want as much of a sharpening because it'll just make it those like those high contrast fine details make them a little brittle rather than like a nice smooth round feeling print. So for this, I had it pretty high because it was a matte paper. You can, you know, that might even been at a setting from a while ago where I was just playing around and kind of previewing things. So, you know, setting between 100 and 200 might do all right here. And then we can just go up to print. So if we do a sharpening as a local adjustment in the printing stage here, we're going to need to turn the sharpening all the way down because we don't want to double sharpen this. So here I'm going to actually change printers. And I'm going to do that by going to print settings and change this to the color printer. And I have a preset for a advanced black and white setting here. I need to get off of that, go down to printer settings, and we want to use the advanced photo HD because we're gonna using that that ICC profile we just defined in the output settings. So here I'm going to change this to no color management. I want it highest resolution possible, and this is going to be on a glossy paper. So you know, you're going to have to, unless you're making your own ICC profiles with a photospectrometer I1 profiler or the Spider Print, you're going to need to follow the paper manufacturer's recommended media settings. The media settings are all done on the original printer papers, like the Epson Premium Photo Glossy paper, or you know, you have a few other fine art papers in here. So what the profiling companies do, like the Ilford Golden Mono Silk, or the paper manufacturing companies, they're going to make those profiles based on some other people's or Epson's media settings, and you need to follow those so you can have a direct. You know, you want to use the profile that the media settings the profile was made on. So some are better at like telling you exactly what settings to use, and some just say use the highest quality possible, which is the case with this Ilford paper. So use this premium photo paper glossy, say save, and then we can go back to the print output here. So I always use the highest, for small prints at least, I use the finest detail setting. And so Capture One does that as either 360 or 720. So I'm gonna use 720. And I'm not actually gonna print this, because it's gonna take a little while. But at this point, if I had the image size the way I wanted it here, you can change that by the cell width and all that. And you can look at other resources for that. We don't have time to go into that here. But in this case, this is ready to go. We've applied an ICC profile and we're using the color driver to use this toning we set in that black and white setup. So here we're gonna press print and we're gonna have a print. It's gonna look great. I'm actually gonna cancel out of that and show you another workflow now. So, so that's if you're using this split tone in the black and white settings here. What I'm going to do now is undo all that and show you a way to work with the either Epson or Canon's their own. They all have their kind of own black and white dedicated driver. And in some ways, it's better in that it uses less color ink, puts the dots sometimes closer together, and does some behind the scenes adjustments that attempt to match what you see on your screen to what you would get in the final print. The problem with this workflow though is you can't actually use an ICC profile for color managing, for converting to that destination space when you're sending it to the printer. So what we do here is just preview in, I'm gonna go up to grayscale, 16-bit gray gamma 2.2, and that's probably something I created myself just using, you can see the profile recipe I have in here. But this is just going to do a quick workflow using the advanced black and white driver in the Epson printer. I'm going to go back to the local adjustment before doing that. You know, I'm not going to do any more tonal adjustments. I'm just going to turn off the sharpening. So I'm going to go down to the sharpening setting and turn that off. I might just mention real quick that in, you know, as I do sharpening as a local adjustment, you can do the same as with noise reduction. So if you're making a print that might look a little larger and you're blowing up some noise in the image, you can increase some of the noise reduction and maybe mask that in, even using another local adjustment. So it just gives you a lot of options. It's a pretty powerful way to finally control your print rather than just relying as like sending a flat TIFF to a printer. So this next, I'm gonna go back to the way I have that in gray gamma 2.2, no color toning in the black and white setting here. This is all coming back down to zero. So we go to printer and I'm still gonna use this, I call my color printer saw lighter. If I'm using a black and white driver, I actually named it minor white, but I disabled that for now. So that's why you see this thing called saw lighter. It's just a custom name for the printer. So I'm gonna go back down to print settings and change this. I still have the preset set there. In printer setting, we have the advanced black and white driver. So this is going to use primarily the light black, the light black, and the black dilutions, and then add a little color based on these other settings here. So you have a few, I'm just kind of clicking back and forth here. You have a few color toning options. You might just see neutral. I tend to want a little warmth in it, like I said. So I'm going to maybe kind of start with the warm setting here. Then in advanced color settings, we can go back to that and adjust based, you can see a little small preview here, but this is the best you're going to do for quote unquote soft proof of your color toning. And, you know, I can show you a different way using a different print driver to affect color in a different way and even give you an option for soft proofing. You can't print with the color management, but you can soft proof this Tony mix. So I'm gonna just slide this down to something around like 4 on the red side and about 8 on the yellow side. Let me narrow that down, 8 to 10. This gives just a little bit of a color away from the, away from that perfectly neutral. It just kind of give it a little more richness. The other options here, I tend to leave all these alone if I'm doing this advanced black and white printing driver. The max optical density will actually decrease your Dmax, and we don't want to do that here. If you're starting to flood the paper, you might want to do that. But in general, leave all these the same. And this tone, these are some pretty vague options here. But what seems to work best is this dark, this kind of middle option. Leave this highlight point shift off for now. So that's a pretty quick introduction to advanced black and white. If you wanted to make a soft proof of this, there are a couple options for doing that. You can use like a Adobe Color Printer utility, get a 21-step target, print that with no color management using these settings here. And then in what I'll show you in a little bit, Quad Tone Rip has a nice little utility that take a measurement file from that 21-step target and will actually create an ICC profile that you can use to soft proof this color mix here. So if I say cancel, I'll actually show you one I made earlier this afternoon. So in the profile recipe or output recipes, instead of this gray gamma 2.2, I'm going to scroll down to this Quad Tone Rip Ilford Gold Mono Silk Advanced Black and White Worm Neutral. And we're looking at a compressed video feed from around the world. So you're not gonna see the subtle shift that I just saw on my display, but it actually, the tonal differences didn't change much, which is a good thing. But it did bring up a little bit of that warmth that we're getting from the color of that black and white mix. So this is a way you can just preview that effect on the display. If you're using a matte paper, there might be more shadow compression as it's trying to reach what the screen might be. So you might see a little bit of that as you apply this profile for soft proofing. You'll see that when I go to the printer, it's actually not going to allow me to, change to this output space here. Oh, you know what? I think and they're talking about the color driver. I didn't actually change the profile here. I left it alone in the output recipe. But in any case, if we were to choose that profile here and then go to print settings and back down to advanced black and white, you'll see it's blocked, it's grayed out. We can't change that. So in the printer driver here, if you want to use advanced black and white, you have to change the color profile to manage by printer, and that will enable that advanced black and white feature. So that's just a quick rundown of doing, you know what, I'm sorry. I disabled sharpening in the local adjustment, so we need to increase it in the printer output. Here is where you'll need to do a little bit of testing and previewing for yourself. It'll depend on the size of image you're making, this amount that I'm changing here, and the type of image, and your own personal preferences. So I think the default is, some number called 50 on the scale of 1 to 100. I did a print the other day testing this, and 50 is much, like, way too much sharpening, this setting of 50 here. 25 is on the verge of being too much. So I tend to go between 10 and 15 for maybe this size picture, like 8x8 to 12x12 is what I've done before here. So, we're gonna play, it'll be up to you to play with this. Just know that higher contrast image might need less sharpening. Something with a little more subtle detail might need a little more sharpening, but it's going to depend on the image and the paper, the surface material of the paper, if it has any texture. In most cases, the dots don't bleed with these new paper coatings. Going back 10, 15 years, you might need to increase the sharpening based on how the dot bleeds when it hits the page. So, I don't like to use a lot of plugins. So or predefined sharpening algorithms. I kind of like to preview what I'm seeing, which is why I do that as a local adjustment. I can zoom in to 100%, see how much sharpening is being applied, and then back off if I need to. I'm just going to check the time real quick. 3:30.
Yeah, sorry, Richard, we're about halfway through. If we pause
okay.
for a second, then I'll throw a couple of questions at you, which have been coming through on a common theme. So there's quite a few actually. So first of all, Russell was asking, if you consider the color space of the, generally of an inkjet printer, does it make a difference using a wide gamut monitor, versus a smaller gamut sRGB only monitor, or the impact is negligible on the output?
Yeah, because the gamut of the paper is so low, using a wide gamut monitor might not have, it's not going to contribute to anything because the gamut of the paper and the printer is so much smaller. What you might do, or what you might gain from one of these 10-bit displays, is better representation of smooth gradients. I mean, if you're working in Photoshop, you make a gradient and zoom in, or if you're doing a gradient mask. You can see actually the steps of the gradient. That's just your display showing you the steps. In the actual print, you might not see them. So, in terms of gradients, some of these prints are going to be smoother than what you see on the display. If you're using kind of an older display or one that only has 8-bit lookup tables, using those new 10-bit displays and those that 10-bit feature. I'm not sure if Capture One has that support for the 10-bit displays, but we're working with grays, and the light emitting from the back of the display, it's going to look a whole lot different than actual light reflecting off of a printed surface. So at best, it's going to be a close approximation, but you really need to trust your print. That's why I like to print this grayscale target here, to know exactly where those tones are going to fall based on color readouts.
Sure. And actually, Antoine was asking, that's a grayscale you made yourself, wasn't it, that image?
Yeah, so yeah. I made this in probably I1 Profiler, just defining a target and then putting it into Photoshop and laying on some of these color values. And in the follow-up email, there'll be links to this target with the with the text overlay, and then one where you can actually print and measure yourself if you,
okay,
if
great.
You want.
Perfect. So a couple of people were asking about that as well. Good resolution questions from Marco and John. The first one, why is the output resolution higher than 300 DPI, potentially more than the camera could offer? And probably linked to that, John was asking, there's a discrepancy between the 720 DPI setting in the Epson panel in Capture One and the 2880 DPI setting in the system print dialog. But that's two different things, really, you're speaking about there, isn't it? As I understand it, but you might be able to expand on that subject.
Yeah, sure thing. So starting with version 9, the interpolation algorithms, the resizing algorithm in Capture One has been upgraded. And so my output resolution, I'm going to convert that for the most part, I leave it alone until, unless I'm exporting a TIFF to print in some other program or application. What's going to happen is Capture One's going to resize that to whatever the printing resolution is. So Epson, the fine detail setting is 720, or like the standard print mode is 360. And there does some, it puts the, you know, dots closer together. It might overlap the dots a little more and change the dot size with the variable drops. You know, this is all kind of a black box, and you're gonna have to, like, buy a couple people at Epson a few beers to really get the right answer. But but what this is doing is just saying, like, it's thinning, it's gonna print at 720, even though the printer is capable of, you know, laying dots down to it, 2,880 dots per inch. It's still sending it's converting at some point to 720. I'm going to allow Capture One to do that in the printing stage rather than, you know, exporting a TIFF at 360 at, you know, whatever size the camera resolution is, and then allow the operating system to do it. Like, the operating system's not going to do as good of a job interpolating that to the final print resolution as Capture One is. I hope they answered that question.
good. Well, I'm sure John will tell us if not. John says, good answer, thanks. Okay. sorry, I'm just looking at the various questions. Why use Managed by Printer? What's wrong with Managed by Capture One? That's Harold asking.
Yeah, so if you're using the Managed by Capture One, so if we scroll down and grab that that IC, I'm just going to grab some printing one here.
Paper profile, yeah,
so there's one mix there. If I do that in, and I'll use relative, it's basically you can use perceptual or relative. There's not much color here, so it's not going to change much. If you use relative, you need to check black point compensation. This is a kind of, you saw how those print or the shadow tones blocked up quite a lot. That's a QTR, quad tone rip profile based on like a different paper surface, and so that's why those are blocking up. We'd have to do some kind of soft proofing to lighten those back up in the print stage. Let me go down to the advanced black and white one here and choose perceptual. It's still looking a little blocked up, isn't it? I would have to go back here and cancel. I just want to make sure I'm going to say the right thing here.
That's okay.
Yeah, it's not changing here. It's only changing in the print screen. Basically, if we choose some other profile here, it's going to disable the advanced black and white setting in the print settings.
Okay.
So now if we go down to print settings, you see it's this AccuPhoto HD is the only print mode we can use.
Right. So by
that's why you say managed by printer.
Based on the printer driver, you might get some settings that you want to explore, I guess.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay. Let me. So does that cover those questions?
Yeah. I think the other answer. The other question, not answer. Very specific one from Pat, so this will just be a quick answer because it's kind of interesting. Have you explored any way of printing on a kind of substrate to create a digital negative and then take that into a wet dark room and then either print that on papers?
Absolutely. That's if you look at my website, there are a lot of platinum plating prints, and all those have been created with digital negatives. I've been doing that since 2009 maybe. So I just actually moved not too long ago and finally got the darkroom set up, and I made my first, I want to say, a quote unquote real print just like 2 days ago. So I'm kind of I've been writing about making digital negatives, quad tone rip, all these sorts of things, kind of over the last little, few years, really. But I'm putting all that together in a book that, hopefully it was supposed to be out, last year, but you know how books go. So
Absolutely.
I'm in the kind of the final stages now. So hope to have like a pre-sale page up in the next few weeks to a month, and hopefully release in the next month or two, really. But in any case, the point is, from here, you would actually need to take this into Photoshop, invert into Photoshop, and then send to the printer. There's, not a million, but a few different ways of doing that, and it's a completely different subject. But a lot of the work I've done has been not a lot, a fair amount of work I've done is starting in Capture One with digital capture, doing the raw conversions, exporting a TIFF into Photoshop, doing a little bit more adjustment for output to a digital negative, then inverting in Photoshop, applying some correction curves, and then going and print in the darkroom. So yes, it can be done. Capture One does a really good job getting you to a great starting point with that, but you do need to take it a few steps further. I just got an email from Piezography and John Cohn about their new digital negative system, which I got this email between the two sessions here,
Oh,
and it seems
interesting.
that you're going to be able to do some soft proofing with some ICC profiles directly to platinum palladium, and then not even need to invert. You can just print right from Capture One straight to a digital negative. So
Fantastic.
it hasn't been released as a product yet, but it's kind of in the final stages of testing, and I think they're teaching it privately or kind of on a not even one by one basis, but like on a workshop basis before the actual product release. So that's pretty exciting. I can't wait to dive into that.
Yeah, fantastic. And the last question, which is kind of two rolled into one, actually, one from Herb and one from, sorry, I'm just going through the list. Yeah, here we go. So one from Herb, one from Joe. Herb was asking a little bit about monitor settings or calibration settings for monitors, which we did speak about in the earlier session. And then Joe was, I guess, struggling with how would you make adjustments based on the screen compared to then viewing the print, which is done with ink or pigment. So you've got transmissive light and reflective light, two very different things. But I guess that ties in a little bit as well with having good monitor calibration settings.
Right. So, these displays nowadays, like I said, they have bigger color gamuts than you can really print. They also can emit more light than you really are going to be able to reflect off a piece of paper. So, my general recommendation is profile at between 5500 and 6500. Profile your monitor between 55 and 6500. I think mine now is, I actually know it's profiled to 6500 right now. Actually, it feels too blue for me, but, I might warm it up based on just like comfortable working conditions and the room light that I'm in. But you can go crazy doing this. And for printing color, it's sometimes you want to the temperature of your lights are going to change the color on the page. If you're printing black and white, your eyes are going to do like a brain a white point calibration based on the paper brightness and the paper color. So it's not as important to have, super controlled lighting when you're doing black and white printing. But you do want to have the consistent intensity of light. So I keep my monitors around 100 to 105 candelas per meter squared, and then profile based on that. So like it at the work studio I have a large format NEC display that's hardware calibrated. At home here I just have like an older desktop Apple monitor that I just use I1 Profiler to calibrate or profile. But those end up being around 100 candelas per minute squared and white point around 6,500. And I hope that answers it, but that's just a good kind of place. You kind of want to just have a good stable point of reference. Make all your prints under those conditions, and no matter where you take them, they're all going to be the same relative to each other. And hopefully, unless you're like viewing them by candlelight, they're all going to be the right brightness. You don't want to have you don't want to go like Edward Weston is a good example. He would walk out of the dark room under a skylight and look at his prints and like looks beautiful, right? Then you go now 100 years later, but like we're getting there. 100 years later, we go to a museum and the lights are dim, really, really dim. And everyone's like, oh my God, these prints are so dark. Mm. He wasn't printing them to be viewed at super dim light in a museum under, anti-reflective glass and all that. So just know that, if you're going to view them in a really bright light, you might want to increase the monitor brightness also. But in general, if you take them anywhere else, the prints are going to be too dark. So, you can go too far one direction or too far in another. So just, keep it kind of standard room lights and don't put it in front of a big photo flood and then you judge your prints that way. So hope that answers the question. It's kind of a roundabout way of answering it, but just keep it consistent. That's the point.
Cool. Nice one. Good answer. And the last question, which is going to actually lead you into your next section, is about do you ever feel the need to use a rip? So this probably leads quite nicely into a quad tone discussion, I would think.
Exactly. So yeah. I'm going to cancel out of this just for a moment and go back to the image here. So yes, when I'm printing, essentially all my work is done printing with quad tone rip. I'm just going to go back to gray gamma 2.2 in this setting here. So quad tone rip overrides the printer driver, the Epson printer driver, and allows you to take control over how much ink is being laid down. So instead of relying on Epson's media settings, we're creating our very specific media settings for different ink combinations and different papers. So you can go in and have a system of profiling or calibrating the printer to different papers. It sometimes is less paper. You consume less paper doing it with quad tone rip than you would with printing 1,000 targets and measuring them with to make a color ICC profile. So yes, I do print black and white with an extra rip, and quad tone rip's pretty powerful. It's very affordable. It's like a $50 shareware software. I keep saying that it's worth five times that much, but it's only compatible with Epson inks, not Epson inks, I'm sorry, Epson printers. And the full range is supported, everything from the super old like Epson 3000 from 20 years ago, 15 years ago, to the newest like P100 and like the 7000 or P7000, whatever the newest big whiz bang one is. So they're all supported. What I tend to do if I'm printing glossy is use quad tone rip with the color, the Epson color inks. I can print with piezography, which is an ink set with between 6 and 7 different inks, like all overlapping gray inks. And then you need to use like a overprint, a spray overprint, or like a gloss overprint to neutralize any metamerism. It's not really metamerism; it's just gloss differential based on the different dilutions of the gray inks. So for glossy, I just tend to use the Epson inks with quad tone rip with my very specific media settings, and by doing that, you almost don't even need to use ICC profiles for color managed printing. You can just use controlled by printer, or with a different print layout engine, you can use an option for no color management. That's really nice, kind of getting away from Apple. This is going down a whole other rabbit hole, but the OS now, especially with Macs, they don't want you to print without color management. So it does a behind the scenes conversion from whatever your default setting is to like sRGB and then sends it to the printer. And so that can affect or change your print tones if you're not aware of or expecting it. That's why, while we'll say like controlled by printer here or or just go on to export a TIFF and then print with no color management through this other software. So to show you a little bit of what Quadtone Rip does, I've created a few profiles or media settings, I'll call them. I'm going to change my printer over to print with that. I'm going to leave it as Gray Gamma 2.2. Go to my print settings and just drop down to Quad P800, and that's going to give us this Quadtone Rip interface. So what this allows you to do is have three different ink curves, and I'll bring up a couple graphs here just to show you what I mean by ink curves. But I'll just bring them over to the middle of the screen here. So these three profiles, and these are just graphs of the ink distribution. So this one on the top left is the three gray dilutions. So it's called warm because without any color inks added, the Epson inks are a little bit of a green warm tone. I tend to like them basically just as they are. So most of my prints are gonna be mostly gray inks. Then I incorporate some of these neutral and selenium inks, and those are just, like selenium is just back from the darkroom days. Just kind of describing the color as a little bit more of a pink, pink warmth rather than like a cool warmth. So I'll use a little bit of selenium to give a little more color depth. That actually increases the D-max a little bit because it's adding a little more ink at the end of the scale. And just gives a little bit more, a little more neutrality than just the straight green inks. They're not exactly green, but like the green toned inks. So these things here, these are just graphs of these settings. Let me move them over so you can see a little bit better in Quadtone Rip. It'll probably hide it when I click back here. Yeah. So you can have the split tone option where the highlights, you can have a little more warmth or even more neutral highlights. And then in the shadows, you can bring up some more of that selenium. And so you can play with these and find a mix that you like. Or you could just use, click off that. And as you change one setting, the midtones and shadows are gonna do the others. So I always print the highest resolution here, unidirectional. This black ink, I like to set that at the printer and not make these settings here, just so if I hit the wrong one, it's not gonna switch inks on me when I send it to the printer. So that's just a brief overview of Quadtone Rip. There are a lot of pre-made profiles or calibration settings that you can use for a lot of the more popular papers. But I, like mixing my own chemistry in the darkroom, it's like you want to get in there and see what the printer can do, what each paper can handle, and kind of like just get a better feeling of your materials. If you're not into that, you can just use some of the preset ones. Create if you have a photospectrometer or even a densitometer from the darkroom days, you can use that to make your own ICC profiles. And I'm not actually going to have time to get into that today, but it can be done. And you can't really judge the color with a densitometer, too much math involved, but it can be done. So, if someone wants to send me an email about that, I'm happy to answer those questions. But like before, I'm just going to hit cancel so we can get out of this instead of sending it to the printer. Go ahead.
Questions. Yeah, quad tone again. It looks, I mean, from a novice printer like myself, Quad Tone Rip looks kind of quite daunting to get started in, but is there sort of easy ways to get started, or do they suggest easy settings on the website, which is kind of a bit more sort of plug and play, just so you can get started before you really get into the heavy stuff with it, I guess?
Yeah, so there are, like I said, there are a few calibration media settings that are in there for other papers, glossy and matte papers. And so if you wanted to just kind of see how it works, you can, when you install it, it comes preloaded with some curves. Like they call them curves, those media settings.
Yeah.
And it's just because the shape of the ink looks like a curve. So you have some of those that you can play with. And, if it's not an exact match for that paper, it's going to be fairly close. I can go overboard with this stuff. But if you just, want to see how it works and play with it, like, dive right in. You don't need to start making your own profile. If you do, there's a lot of writing out there, kind of spread out over the place. My book is going to make a very kind of straightforward and systematic profiling method, and a lot of tools I've developed to do that. So, I've kind of spent the last couple of years just testing these things and figuring out what works best. So, that should be out in a, 2 months, like I said. But if you just wanted to play around, like, there are built-in things to do that.
Okay, that's good. Couple of RIP-based questions. Welton was saying, I've been using the Colorburst Overdrive RIP. Colorburst Overdrive RIP. Does that differ much from the Quad Tone RIP, or is there anything you can comment on?
I'm not familiar with it. I don't think I've – well, actually, I've explored all the different ways you can take control over the actual ink limits, like how much ink is being laid down. I am fairly certain the only one other than Quad Tone RIP that allows you to do that is Studio Print by a German company. I'm drawing a blank right now, but it's Studio Print. Image Print does it based on ICC profiles, and I believe the Color Burst, is that it?
Color Burst, yep.
It does it with ICC profiles as well.
Okay.
It has its own. It might have its own resizing and layout engine, but it's still relying on ICC profiles. This is as far as I understand.
Okay. ErgoSoft, does that ring any bells?
ErgoSoft, that's the one, yep.
ErgoSoft, yep. Okay. And a couple of Canon people asking if you know of anything sort of equivalent for Canon users who would like something like Quad Tone RIP.
Yep, there's a company out of Los Angeles, Bauhaus, and it's True Black and White is their printer driver that does essentially the same thing. It's kind of a nicer, I believe it's Mac only. And actually in the follow-up email, I have a link to that.
I've just thrown a few links out on the chat window if anybody's looking. So I've just found that and sent that off. So
yeah,
I've got some resources as well for video tutorials and stuff too.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, carry on.
How's the time looking?
Actually, I have no idea. Oh, we've got 7 or 8 minutes left. So
okay,
we're not drastically over. Yeah.
All right. So, I spoke real quickly about piezography, and I'm going to just bring a couple of those over and kind of show you what that does and how that differs than the color inks. So John Cone developed this originally for the Iris printers. I don't know if anybody remembers Iris printers from, 20 plus years ago. But they were CMYK printers, and he took those inks out and put different gradations of gray inks in there, or black inks. So he called them, I believe, digital platinum at the time. And it actually, Quad Tone RIP comes from those early Epson printers where they were only four inks, and so that's why you get Quad Tones. You have four different gray inks you can put in them to change the thing. There's a little kind of trivia there. Let me bring up a piezography profile here. I've kind of got a lot in for different papers, so I'm just looking at my second screen for a moment to bring over one that works well. So like those graphs I showed you before, each color represents a channel in the printer. So this is a six ink print. So each of these curves here, these mountain looking graphs, are actually gray ink. So even though it says yellow, it just means that it's the ink in the yellow position. So it's six different dilutions of gray ink. And what that allows you to do is print with more smoothness, especially in the highlights. So, to print a lighter tone with a dark ink, you need to spread the dots apart. What John Cone's done is made this so it looks effectively like a continuous tone image. He likes to say that it's, tens of thousands of gray tones, which in a way is true because each along this 256 step, there are 1 to 65,000 plus different levels of ink that can be laid down. And when you overlap those, you have, that times four sometimes. So you can have really, really smooth gradations that affect some of the subtleties in the print. And if I back to the image here and just hit cancel, what that'll allow you to do is in something like these smooth tones here, where like it's blurred water, if you have like a blurred sky, you'll get more just a feeling of smoothness. It's really, it's perceivable. It's hard to talk about, but if you see it, you can point out the differences. The other thing he likes to say is that it gives more open shadows. So you have more steps between, because the papers are profiled and calibrated in such a way that there are each step between, you know, like 98 and 100 are much smoother than if you were using like the color ink or the color driver, where you might lose shadow details. So you can really control those like finest shadow details. You can push it right up to the D-max of the paper, and just it's another one of those things where it's more of a perception than like some kind of technical. I mean, it is technical, but you know, but it's because of the perception of a print. It's like it keeps the roundness as you approach that D-max of the paper. So if I'm printing matte papers, that's generally what I'm using. I've printed exhibitions on even like a small home. You know what I chose here. Let me bring this up again. I'll go to the print settings and just change that to this quad 1430K6, and go down to quad tone rip. So quad tone rip is what drives the piezography inks. It's totally compatible with that driver. So I know I need to kind of talk about one other thing real quick. But anyway, you have these different ink curves. There's only one though. You can't split tone with the piezography because you introduce banding and gradients if you try using thing where like you have 12 inks overlapping now. So right, you just use a one curve, one set of curves, and go ahead and print, and it's going to look beautiful. So this is all Mac based. If you are going to print with quad tone rip for a PC, you need to export a TIFF and then load it into its own driver, its own application. So to do that, I would define the print settings here. I'll go to the long edge, type in 360. If you have one of the new 100 megapixel cameras, like go ahead and make that 720. So it's going to resize it to 720 pixels per inch at 20 inches, and you know, fantastic. Otherwise, you might leave it at 360. And since it's just a linear interpolation or bilinear interpolation, you're not going to lose any detail going from 360 to the native 720 that quad tone rip has. So if I want to make this like a 12 by 12, I would export a grayscale, a 16-bit grayscale, 12 inches at 360 dpi, and just go down to process, and it'll spit out a TIFF that I like to have like a, if I'm doing this, have a folder that is specifically for printing. You can choose that in output location. Custom name, all that stuff. You know, that's something for other webinars. But then you'd have to load that. I don't have a virtual machine open here to start up Windows. So I'm not actually going to show you that workflow, but that's what you'd have to do. And that is the same if you're going to print, send this to like a service to print this for you. If you know, if you were going to send me a print, because I do custom printing for people, if you're going to send me a file to print, you would essentially do the same thing. You would have a 16-bit grayscale TIFF, or if you wanted some color, some kind of color split tone option, you would choose the Adobe RGB. Make your final print size, so whatever your width is and the resolution, and that's because I want Capture One to do that resizing rather than the OS or you know some other program doing the resizing for you. So you'd have all your settings there. Export a TIFF and then you know Dropbox or FTP the file to somebody to print it for you. So that kind of killed two birds with one stone there in terms of talking about Windows and sending this to a third-party printer. and I think we're coming in just about 2 minutes left. So
yeah. So I've got three good questions to finish on.
Okay.
So that's 30 seconds a question, but we can overrun it. Okay. Good question from Wallace. What's a good quality printer to start the journey if you have any recommendations?
So I am always a fan of buying used if possible. You know, especially if you're doing the conversion to the straight black and white ink sets. So like a 38 to 3800 is a good Epson one to start with. If you're buying new, I think the P800 is a great deal. One problem with the P800 is they kind of disabled the refillable cartridges. Kind of, it's impossible to do at this point. So if you're only going to print color, the P800 is a good option. Color, I'm sorry, when I say print color, I mean with color inks, not third-party ink sets. If you're going to do a third-party ink set and, you know, just want to have a small, inexpensive printer, the 1430 is a good option. I know the P600, there's still allow, no, I mean, they don't allow it, but it's still possible to use third-party refillable carts. It's a smaller, I said P600, correct. A smaller, it's like a 13-inch wide printer, but that's a good one to start with also.
Okay, and this is probably links a little bit to Mark's question. So you run separate printers for Epson color inks and Piezography inks, correct? Because I imagine switching from one to the other is like pouring money down the drain.
Exactly. If you have long, you know, if you have a 9900 or like a 9890, you know, it's going to spit out a lot of ink. And there's an issue with the initial fill settings with some of those larger printers. You have to do power cleanings, and that's just overworking the printhead. So once you convert, leave it there, really. That's, and you know, unless you have something like the older 2880 printer where the actual cartridges are on the printhead, you're not going to, you're going to waste a little ink, but you can take those out and swap them, you know, all day long and not really lose much.
Because otherwise you're draining a ton of ink through any connective hose from cartridge to head. So it's probably cheaper in the long run to have two printers than one, I guess, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah. As it's, I think I read somewhere that printer ink is one of the most expensive commodities in the world. So
yeah, it's like more than like liquid gold or something.
Yeah, don't buy gold, buy ink. And the last question, Russell was asking, you personally, do you do the bulk of your printing with Epson or with the Piezography inks?
My personal work is mostly on matte paper with Piezography inks. It's a custom, you know, that's the nice thing about doing this stuff yourself is you can take some like the carbon ink set and like some of the selenium ink set, use syringes to custom mix and custom blend and then profile out. Either you could actually just probably use his own profiles, but I do everything myself here. So I profile them out with that.
Okay, nice. Great. All right, that was pretty much bang on an hour. Pretty good. So what I'm going to do is just steal back presentation rights, but don't go away, Richard, because I just want to mention for those of you who are perhaps new to – oops, sorry. For those of you who are perhaps new to Capture One, next week is just a pretty simple webinar, what's new in Capture One Pro 9.1, because we released Capture One Pro 9.1 last week, or maybe it was a week before, I can't remember now, week before, I think, which had a bunch of new features and so on, not necessarily related just to black and white, but version 9 certainly had some new features which help you in your printing with the better resizing algorithm for example as well. So if you want to come along next week and just see what's new in Capture One, please do so. I'll send out my own follow-up email in 24 hours time roughly, which has some resources to sign up for the new webinars and other stuff as well. And Richard will send out his own mailing from his service as well with all the kind of resources that he's spoken about today as well. So sorry if we didn't get to all of your questions. I think we pretty much covered most of it. And yes, that was Mark who was asking, could we post links referencing QuadTone? And yes, we're going to, definitely. So I think the last time we did a webinar, Richard, you posted a pretty comprehensive set of resources and links. So if you give Richard a bit of time, I'm sure you'll do the same thing, correct?
Yeah, I have that page still up on the website. It's kind of a hidden page. It's only for the webinar resources. So yeah, you'll have a link to that in the email and a couple of their special offers that you'll get in the email too.
Okay, nice one. We like special offers.
Yeah, everybody loves those.
Yeah, and as I said, we recorded this, so if the any part of it you forgot or you want to review again, then it will be on the YouTube channel in probably Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday next week, something like that. So let it sink in, and then you can watch again next week. Good stuff. All right, Richard, thanks very much for your time. We should leave you to get on with your busy day of printing, I'm sure. And thanks to everyone who joined, and hope to see you all again soon. Cheers, Richard.
All right, cheers. Thanks, everybody.
Take care. Bye.
All right, bye.